Good evening, Bedford. Welcome to the November edition of Bedford Common. I'm Ron Cortes.
And I'm Julie Turner, and I'm really thankful to be here. How about you?
Okay.
Well, isn't that what we're celebrating this
Absolutely.
Month?
Absolutely.
Oh, all right.
Absolutely. And we'll actually hear a lot more about that in the last segment of the show. And I'm not going to say any more than that,
there
so you've
go.
Got to
a
stay
teaser.
Tuned.
A teaser.
But if it is November, it means there's an election coming up, November 6th, and fall town meeting. I'm not even going to call it special town meeting anymore. Fall town meeting, which this year is Tuesday, not Monday, right. Tuesday, November 13th. Why? Because Monday is the
observed holiday. Although Bedford's Veterans Day ceremonies will take place on Sunday, November 11th, as usual.
But the observed holiday is Monday, so we can't do it then, so it is Tuesday, November 13th. So I'll see you there. So in our first segment, we have the usual suspects. We have Kathy Cortes, who is chair of the Selectmen, Jonathan Silver, who's chair of the Planning Board, and Ann Bickford, who's chair of the School Committee. Welcome to you all.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
So, Ann, why don't you start off? Let's go
left
to right.
I'll be happy to. we're into fall. We got fall sports underway. The soccer season seems to be going very well for the varsity and JV, and football is going well. So the other teams are all working hard. But so that's, you know, big use of fields. More to come on the field issue. We'll be just a little bit about what we spent a lot of time on Tuesday night that we'll be hitting more of within the community, and that is how the puzzle of enrollment and class size and space needs all looks to be coming together, and relative to the question of whether we do or don't need additional space at the elementary schools that had been predicted a couple years ago, and what we do about the issue of class sizes, which have crept up remarkably high, particularly at Bedford High School. So we spent a lot of time on that on Tuesday night, trying to put all those pieces together in projections and figure out what we need. And the good news, bad news of it, the short version of the story, is that it is looking more and more that we can probably manage the enrollment increases without the additions at Davis and Lane, which will be very good news for the capital budget if that it does come to pass, because that was a projected $4.6 million capital need for the town. Mm-hmm. There will be some offsettings of that in terms of how to reconfigure the space. The price tag, we're still working out on that. Something in the $300,000 range instead of $4.6 million is probably the range that we're going to be in, which is some very good news.
That's a pretty good trade-off. Yeah.
On the other side, some which will be a challenge, is that we will need to be doing some issues of staff, because our class sizes have gotten up tremendously high. We're at a level of the high school that hasn't been seen since about 1976 at Bedford High School.
What is the average class size, Ann?
Well, right now the issue is really at the high school, where we have, 5 years ago we had nine classes that were core courses, not the band and orchestra and stuff, that were greater than 25 students. And presently we have 46. So we've gone up to some, and 11 of those have classes close to 30. So the big bubble that we've got at the high school now is impacting the core courses, which is leading us to, and the projections all seem to be verifying that that's going to stay. We're going to stay up at the 880, 900, 950 level for the next 7 years at the high school because of the bubbles that have come through at the elementaries.
So that's not really a bubble. That's more like a plateau.
Right. So what's happened to the high school is that it's peaked early. That peak was projected for 2017. It's here now. So that's the story. There'll be more to come on that. Good news, challenge, both sides of the coin. Other just real quick things, we dedicated a place called the Play Zone yesterday, which was dedicated to Judy Morell, who was 35 years as the early education coordinator in town, and that's the area outside of the integrated preschool that's actually now formally available for the students there to get outdoor time and structured play time. And what's wonderful about that initiative is that it was community driven. There was private fundraising that went on for that effort, and it was all dedicated yesterday, which was a really terrific thing. And the last thing is that Saturday night there is a concert at Bedford High School in honor of Bill Toland, who was the longtime band director in the town. People will remember him from the 70s and 80s. He passed away in this past year. When he left Bedford, he went on to found and invigorate the Concord Band. So it's actually the Concord Band that's putting on the concert at Bedford High School in his honor. If people are interested in tickets, they can go to the website for the Concord Band. And so that's one that will resonate, I think, with a lot of people in town.
So that's great.
That's what we have.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you.
And the Planning Board?
I'll try and keep it brief as well. We've got a lot of exciting things to talk about at the town meeting. On the regulatory front, we've got a few projects that have come forward. A new one on 100 Plank Street, which is near the village of Taylor Pond. It's actually a subdivision of that. So that would be a new development under the mixed-use bylaw that governs that area. And the proponent of that has come before us on a number of occasions now just to sort of gauge our temperature for a bunch of different ideas. But what it looks to be is a mixture of offices, but these are not offices in the sense that you traditionally think of, but more home office. And a home office and in a common area for people that are living in the area to utilize a common area for their businesses that they have, that they're running out of their apartments, which is an increasingly common way to structure your business now. In fact, a lot of businesses here encourage their employees to work out of their houses. So this is getting out in front of that idea. So this isn't formally yet, but it's going to be coming before us in December. So we're looking forward to hearing a little bit more about that and getting it on a more of official track. There's an indication, but it's not certain at this point, that the Bedford VA is going to come before us with a proposal for their older vets housing. They don't have to come before us since it's a federal agency, but they may do a site plan review in order to just make sure that they're being good citizens and to accommodate, you know, feedback from the town that they're in. So we're looking forward to hearing more about that. That's going to be about 50 to 100 units of one bedroom for vets over 55. Probably most likely 70 units in that frame, that area. There's something coming along in the Middlesex Turnpike, an expansion of the Mettler-Toledo building. I know absolutely nothing about that. So I'm looking forward to hearing that. That's going to come before us on November 13th. I don't know. I think it's just an expansion of an addition onto a building, but I don't know much more about it than that. And then, of course, there's the comprehensive plan, which continues to march forward, and we're very excited. We've just been through the next section, which was transportation, a very important part. So that draft was put in front of not only the planning board, but also our steering committee, and we had a good discussion about that, and the next one to come before us will be land use and services and facilities, so, and recreation, which plays into one of the things that you're going to be talking about next. So we continue to march ahead. Our timeline to complete this is summer of 2013. We're still on target for that, and so as I find out more about that, I'll keep you all informed. And that's pretty much it at this point.
Well, thank you. That's great. It's a good update. It's always good to hear, keep track of, make sure you guys are doing what you're supposed to be doing. Oh, no, I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's right. They actually go out and just play around every couple of, no.
So, Kathy, town meeting.
Town meeting.
How exciting.
It is that time of year.
When is town meeting going to happen again?
Town meeting is happening Tuesday, November 13th at 7:30 p.m. And it's not a particularly long warrant. There are, I think, 11 articles total. 13, sorry. But I think it'll be an interesting one, as it usually is. The first article that I want to talk about, there's some housekeeping and some simple articles to begin. We always start off kind of smooth, you know. But Article 4 is the high school synthetic turf field at Sabarin Field, putting synthetic turf on Sabarin Field. There are a couple of things that have changed since the springtime when this was also on the warrant. So let me go through a list. First of all, the community preservation article has been, the rules and regulations for the use of those funds have changed. And one of the things that has changed is that now you can use community preservation funds to renovate an existing field. Before, you could only use community preservation funds for recreational purposes to create new mm-hmm. opportunities for.
Yeah, I remember that came up at Springtown meeting and it was an issue.
Right, but now you can use it to renovate existing fields. The catch to that is that you cannot use it to purchase turf, artificial turf. It's a whim of the Massachusetts legislature. I can't begin to explain it. But you can use it to renovate fields. You just can't purchase the synthetic turf. So we can actually use community preservation funds to do all of the preparation work at the football field for synthetic turf. But the synthetic turf will have to be paid for from the regular budget. So in addition to that, as you recall at town meeting, people wanted more information. They wanted us to study it further. They wanted to show that there was a need. They wanted us to do all of the background. We appointed a committee to look at the issue of adding the of turfing that field, and to look in general at the issue of field use across the board. Mm-hmm. And the report, the draft report, it's not quite final yet, but the draft report has come in, and there are two major factors that I find compelling in this argument for synthetic turf. Number one is the number of hours that we need turf, that we need fields for, mm-hmm. And the number of hours that an average field should be working 300 hours a year. Our fields are working more like 1,000, especially in the fall, because there are so many teams at the high school and the middle school, and they all need full-size fields. And that, it turns out, is one of the driving forces for the need here. They're heavily used right now. Because they're overused, they're overscheduled. They're using, a lot of the teams at the high school are using fields that are not even fields. They're just open space. They're grassy open space. And that's what they're using for their practices. But all of this creates a situation where we can't do the kind of maintenance that we need to do on those grass fields so that they're safe to play on, so that they have rest time in between heavy, heavy use. And it just creates this vicious cycle. So one of the things that putting in a turf field will do is reduce the pressure on that. Right now, the football field during football season is only used for football games and for, I guess, soccer games, but limited basis. This will open it up because the field can be used all the time without impacting the condition of the field. But the other point that was made very clearly, and this report is available online, it's on the Bedford Town website. And so you can go and download the report right now and read the report. You'll hear a presentation about this at town meeting. The other big issue is the total number of fields that are needed at any one time. And you know, you think, well, maybe that's a scheduling issue. But it's not just a scheduling issue. Again, it has to do with the number of teams, the multiple sports that are played between the middle and the high school, and the time in which the limited hours in which they have to practice.
Sure.
Creates a not just the number of hours that we need fields, but the number of full-size fields that we need. And so not only do we need to turf this field, we are also going to have to figure out how to have an additional field or two. Community Preservation Committee has been working for the past 5 years on creating new fields, because that's what we could do. So that was where our energies were put. Mm-hmm. And we have been looking at the land that we purchased at Lilgren and Mudge Way, which is commonly known as the St. Michael's land. And we have focused in on creating playing fields there.
Well, that land was specifically bought for playing fields, right? I mean, that was the argument for the town to put up the $2 million or something to buy that land.
When the land was originally purchased, yeah. Right. So we have been looking at how to create fields there, about what needed to be done to create fields there. And we've now been through the preliminary studies. We've done the design, not the design work, but preliminary design work. And we've done all the permitting. So we've now gotten that through Conservation Commission. It's ready to be permitted. We have to do some replication of wetland, but it's only a small portion. And so that is also something you will see in Article 6. So to return just briefly to the high school synthetic turf field, the idea is that we would bond, probably we will do bonding for the portion of the project that cannot be paid for from community preservation funds. Mm-hmm. Community preservation funds can pay for up to $605,000 worth of the project. The remainder will have to be bonded from town funds. Community preservation actually has $250,000 in cash that we will put toward this effort. And then we will bond the remaining $355,000, which will be paid for by community preservation funds.
So there are really two bondings that are going to have to take place.
No, it'll be wrapped all in one bonding. It's just the source of that pays the bond what has to be delineated.
Okay.
So the next article then is to continue the community preservation surcharge. This is an article that appears on every fall town meeting warrant. The town has the opportunity to understand what community preservation funds have been used for and to decide whether or not the town wants to continue. If we were to get out of the program, we would have to vote both at town meeting and at probably the town election in March. And it would have to pass in both places in order to get out of the program. Even if we get out of the program, we would continue to have to raise some percentage in order to pay off the bonds that we now have on the land that we bought out on Concord Road. And I think we haven't finished paying off the work that we just did at Town Center. So those are two bonds that will continue to have to be paid. So that's also on the warrant. Article 6 is the community preservation budget amendments itself. The good news is that we just got the distribution from the state. And when we presented the budget to town meeting in March, we never know how much we're going to get from the state, because it depends on a crazy formula and a huge number of factors. When the Community Preservation Fund was when the Community Preservation Act was amended recently, they also amended the funding source to add an additional amount of funds. But those additional amount of funds, number one, this won't hit this year. It won't hit until next year. And it's dependent on the state budget having a surplus.
Mm.
So we're not really sure that we can count on the state budget having a surplus. But at any rate, when we project the revenue that we are going to get in any one year, we project in a conservative fashion, and we projected 21%. We actually received 29.86%. So that's good news. There was more money than we expected to have at this time of the year, which is why we could put an additional $100,000 on the turf field. So there are just a few other things that have come up that we need to address in the budget so that we will amend the budget that was there in March. One of the things is a study. We need to do a survey study of the town forest and the Jordan conservation land. The boundaries are not clearly marked, and so we're having trouble with people kind of infringing on the town property, and we want to make sure that everybody understands where the borderline is. That's $3,500. The design money for the fields at Mudgeway and Lilgren Way, the St. Michael's property, the design money is a maximum of $150,000. We've done it that way because it's not clear at this point in time exactly which way we're going to design the fields and exactly how much design work needs to be done. Included in that money is the replication money that we need for the wetlands replication. So the amount is $150,000, and of course when you do an appropriation at town meeting, even though we say it's $150,000, if we don't need $150,000, we don't spend it. Mm-hmm. And that money just reverts back to the community preservation funds. And then the other thing is the affordable housing reserves. We're required by law to do 10%, and we didn't do 10% because we got more money from the state right. than we thought we were going to get, so we need to adjust that number. And that's just a small amount. Article 7 is a housekeeping amendment to the capital projects plan. We're rescinding a line item that we didn't need because we did the work a different way. The other thing, though, is the water quality issue. We've had this problem with the water system this summer. We're working diligently with our consultant. We're working with CDM. We're working with the EPA. We're working with the MWRA. And literally, we are all working together to see if we can find ways to solve this problem. The biggest cause is the length of time the water stays in the water system. And so we are doing a hydraulic map of the town. That was scheduled to be done in the spring. We appropriated money for it in the spring. CDM Smith is our consulting firm that's working with us. And fortunately, that contract was already let, and they were already on site when this problem happened. So we actually had the benefit of one of the best consulting firms around, consulting and engineering firms. And so we continue to work with them, but we had to adjust the contract that we gave them because we needed more of their time than we thought we were going to need. So they have been working with us right along all summer. We need to increase the amount of money for their consulting time. Plus, we're going to add mixing systems. I talked about this on the last show. Mm-hmm. I talked about the fact that the water stagnates in the tanks. It doesn't stagnate. It just sits in the tank longer than it should because the water comes in at the bottom and goes out at the bottom. And so the top of the tank, if there's no way to mix it, the water just kind of sits there. So we are actually going to put mixers in the tanks. So that's part of the solutions to the problem. We are also projecting to reline or redo the water mains on Great Road, which is not going to be a fun project to do. Talk about traffic issues.
Oh boy.
When we start doing that. It's a very complicated project, but we have to get it done.
But that's a future project. That's not something that's
It's already funded, actually. It was part of the $1 million funding that we got last year, in the spring, for the MWRA. There are no interest loans, what we did. And so
But that's not going to get decided at this town meeting.
No, it will not get decided at this town meeting, but that is part of the solution that we need to
work
on.
Overall
water
solution.
So that's part of the overall package. The renovation of Schoolway and the municipal complex access roads and parking areas was on the warrant in the spring. It's back on the warrant. This project is one that we've been working on again for about 5 years, and maybe more than that, because the design issues were very delicate. We knew that we want to improve that intersection. That street is way too wide. Mm-hmm. Parking is not clearly delineated. If you get parking on both sides, the street becomes very narrow. There aren't sidewalks. We identified some funding that can be used for portions of this project on Maple and I think part of Elm. But we remain committed to doing the renovation to this road that really is going to make this a beautiful section of town. Good for pedestrians, good for bikes, good for cars.
Good for the public service vehicles that need to get back and around if there's lots of parking going on.
Absolutely, because the parking's going to be totally changed.
Oh.
But it's also going to be a nicer entrance to the complex here from that side, because the sidewalk will continue all the way around. It's really wonderfully designed, and we think it's a project whose time has come and needs to be done, and so you'll see it back on the warrant.
Well, good. So what else? The rest of this seems to be housekeeping.
It's operating budget changes. There are always a few. Mm-hmm. And then we're trying to put some money back into the stabilization fund, because it's always saving for a rainy day is always good. We've had to dip into those funds, and we have the opportunity to put some money back in, and so we're hoping to do that too.
That's great.
It'll be a fun town meeting. It's always interesting, and I hope that we have a great crowd. I hope you come out.
And when is this going to be?
This is...
Can we say it in concert? All together now.
Tuesday,
November 13th.
At what time?
7:30 p.m.
Hot damn. Well, we'll see you there. You'll be there?
I'll be there, yes.
How about you two?
Absolutely.
You coming?
Yeah.
Okay.
Always.
Good. See that? All the fun people are going to be there. How about you? Come join us. Well, so stay tuned. We'll be
Before
back.
Before you do that,
yes,
I want to thank
ahead.
You for that comprehensive and very succinct overview of what's going to happen at town meeting. Well done.
Thank you.
Selectman Cortez.
Thank you.
Can I throw one more thing in?
Sure.
It is November. This is a show for November.
Yeah.
And it's a home football game on Thanksgiving Day this year.
So, all right.
So be there for
great.
The football
we'll be there,
game.
There you go. Be there. Concord will be there. We'll see who wins. But
be
it's
there.
A home game. Take a break from your turkey.
Yeah. Be there or be square.
Or figure, drum up an appetite.
All right. We'll be back in just a second to find out why this is the 100 best places for kids in the entire bloody country.
It's
like
right
that?
Here. You've just heard
well,
it.
That's a good part of it.
There you go.
But we'll have two
Stay
other good
us.
Reasons coming up. Stay with us.
Hi. Hi, Bedford.
Hello, Bedford. Happy Bedford Day. Take care.
Hi, Bedford. Happy Bedford Day.
Hi, Bedford.
Hi, Bedford.
Bedford Day's awesome.
Woo!
Hi, Bedford.
We're back.
We are.
We are. And this, and in this segment, we're going to talk about a couple of things, including pulling the plug. But I don't understand if you go to Bedford Unplugged, how
there
people can watch Bedford Common, I mean, unless it's
oh,
by candlelight.
And we're talking about
That's
that.
Right.
I didn't know that. Okay.
Yeah,
yes.
Well, that too.
Well,
yes.
I should turn it over to you, Bobby.
But Bedford, last year, Bedford TV was dark on Unplugged Tonight.
That's right.
I think that was the best thing I ever saw. I had to turn it on to see that it was doing that. And I loved that Madeline did that. It was perfect.
There you go.
Yeah.
Can you give us a really quick piece about Bedford Unplugged, because that is one of the reasons, I'll bet, that Bedford became 100 best community.
Well, you know, it might have been in the application. I can't even remember if it was. And I think this year, I didn't bring my Unplugged calendar. I think it's November
7th,
the day after Election Day. That's
yes.
right. So hopefully the returns will be in and people won't have to watch TV or want to watch TV.
And we'll all appreciate the...
The relief. No ads anymore.
No more political ads. Wouldn't that be nice?
Ads.
I know.
Yeah.
It's amazing. This time of year, I actually look forward to used car ads on TV.
What are you watching with used? Never mind. Madeline.
I'm Sue.
That's
but
right.
This is about I can't remember this, whether it's the seventh or eighth year we've done this, but we have been picking a day in the fall. To do Bedford Families Unplugged. We have a calendar of activities, and again, I didn't bring that.
Well, that's okay. We're mostly talking
it's
about
on our website.
Unplugged.
And we've got a couple things. The library is doing a story hour. Bedford Family Connection is doing an ice cream social.
There's a
free
free swim at the Bedford Plaza. So there's a lot of stuff going on, as well as just kind of activities that families can do on their own. And it's a time for families just to remember that even though we use technology much of the day, that really the important part of our lives is the connections that we make with each other. You know, eye contact, conversation, you know, touching, playing, you know, just doing the human stuff that we're meant to do. And so Bedford Community Partnership is the one that kind of developed Unplug, and it was based on Needham Families Unplugged that was started by Needham Youth and Family Services a long time ago. So a number of communities do it, and Bedford is one of them.
And so there are five promises, and the chief is going to help keep some of them alive, and you're going to help tell us about some of them. Our guests, if we didn't actually maybe say that, are Sue Baldauf, who is the director of Bedford Youth and Family Services, and Chief Robert Bongiorno from the Bedford Police Department. We're delighted to have you both with us now that we've jumped right in and gotten started.
So the Bedford Unplugged and the fact that he's now our police chief is probably why we won this award, right? So why don't you tell us about the award?
Yes, so is that?
Yeah, you're the main reason. No, not really. This is, Bedford has won 100 Best Communities for Young People for the fifth year in a row. And I brought the road sign so people could see that.
It is an amazing
thing. It's a huge sign. They're getting bigger every year. I think that if we win it again, that it's going to be twice that size. But we out of 320 applicants, Bedford was one of 100 that was picked. And it's just quite an honor. Again, this is something that the community almost does, I think, naturally, you know, by the way that we run our town, with the way that we make our choices for our kids and our young people, the way Selectmen, you know, school committee, finance committee, you know, work to make decisions. It's based on five promises. I can't remember which of you said that, but, you know, we have a task force that kind of represents the five promises, and Bobby and I are only two of the promises here. Bobby represents safe places, and I represent caring relationships. And we've got school committee as part of schools, as part of that effective education. That's another promise that we make to our young people. Opportunities to serve, and that's a promise that recreation represents on the task force. And then a healthy start, and that is represented by health. And so we all work together. We kind of look at what we're doing for kids in town, and we coordinate, you know, our services. And every year we apply because we think that we're doing a good thing, and they seem to think we are too. So,
how does the Safe Communities fit with your on-the-ground policing?
Well, I think it fits into our mission statement, but I think Sue's being modest here. I think if I could give some credit to her, she's really the coordinator of this. And if it wasn't for Sue's efforts and the coordination of getting all the department heads together, I don't think Bedford would be recognized again for the fifth time. So I think it's quite an honor, and I think Sue really deserves accolades for that. As she mentioned, it's 320 communities, covering all 50 states, including, I believe, Puerto Rico and some of our other territories. Mm-hmm. So again, it's quite an honor. And to answer your question specifically, I think what it does is it allows us to develop partnerships in the community, especially partnerships with our youth. And that's reflective in our SRO program, which is our school resource officers, who are assigned to the high school and to the middle school, working daily with our youth in the school setting and having the youth see the police officers not with a badge and a gun and handcuffs, but as people and as friends. So it's really important, and I think it's a huge component of what makes our program so very successful.
So that's school resource officers.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, the other thing that we're noted for in Bedford is our high graduation rate. And one of the priorities of America's Promise, who is the group that bestows this award on the communities, is that they're working on dropout prevention. And so I think one of the things that we really can be proud of is our high graduation rate and the work that the schools are doing with kids. So that's a really big piece.
Well, in addition to the cake that will be at town meeting.
You know about the cake?
I know about the cake. I've heard about the cake. Is the cake a rumor or real?
No, the cake is not a rumor. The cake will be there.
Outstanding. And so another reason to come to town meeting on November 13th.
And people can get stickers, too. We have stickers that are smaller than the road sign.
But they are very good stickers.
So that's our new town motto, right? Let them eat cake.
Stop. But that's a celebration for the town.
It's a celebration for the town. We'll present the signs, and then there's another award that will be presented at the beginning of town meeting. We're trying to get a national spokesperson to come so that it's not just me, but I'm fingers crossed. I can't divulge anything more. So.
Oh, 2 weeks. We're going to have to wait.
No hints.
It's
like waiting for Christmas. Oh my. So will you? Do you know? Can you tell? Can you share? No.
Well,
no,
I thought it was Julie or Ron, but
no. It isn't us. It isn't us. But the other thing that I found out that I guess maybe I might have known but hadn't heard so clearly, there are some real benefits that come to the town from this award. Tangible benefits.
The last couple years, the last 3 years, we've been given a monetary amount, which we have used. The first year we used it for a community celebration. And we had a dinner before town meeting.
Yeah.
And used it, I think, for supporting that. And then the last 2 years, the amount has increased. And we each of the last 2 years, we've gotten $2,500, which the Youth Task Force then uses to support evening activities at the corner, which is the teen center that is run under the Recreation Department. The monies that the town allocates for that program are enough for some after-school programs, but the Youth Task Force really thinks that evening activities are important for kids, socialization events, and so we use that money to support staffing for evening events at the corner.
Well, I was under the impression that they may have had a dance on October 26th.
There were dances scheduled throughout October and November, throughout the fall at the corner, so that's one of the activities, I think, that which contributes to providing the youth a safe environment, and the corner being one of them. So we take the youth off our streets and put them in a controlled environment where essentially they have fun, and that's what is one of the great benefits to this.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it starts when it doesn't wait until kids are in high school and have sort of formed their paths and their plans. The kids come into the corner when they're in middle school, and so then they can kind of grow up with the program. Mm-hmm.
And the corner has really, since its inception, you know, maybe 4 years ago, I can't remember how long it's been, but it's really gotten more and more kids. This year they've got, 50 to 80 kids come in. And lots of times the kids, you know, kind of drop their backpacks and go off to the library or run and get something to eat and then come back. But again, they feel very comfortable there. And the more the corner does activities and is around, the more kids will use it. And so you're right.
And just to follow up on Sue's point, I think, It's important for the parents, too, because the parents are now safe knowing that their children are in a safe environment.
Yes.
So I think it's a two-way street. It's a safe environment for our youth, but it's also peace of mind for the parents to know where their children are. And I think just as important.
It is.
Well, and the other thing that I kind of noticed about the corner, I had a chance to visit the other day, and I noticed that the staff is young, the staff is there. The staff is present in ways that if they were older might be, and what's going on here? Mm-hmm. But they're there. They're just having fun with the kids, and they're very present.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's true.
Absolutely. And I think knowing some of the staff members is you are absolutely correct. They really interact well with the youth. They can relate. When they see me come in with the gray hair, I think there's a little resistance. But, the people down there do a fabulous job. And I think our youth and our community is better served by that.
Well, is one of the promises sharing information? Can we help with that next year?
How so? How would you?
Well, I don't know. Things like getting this information out to the community.
About 100 Best?
Yeah.
Sure, anything you can do.
Well,
it's really great
know.
That you invited us here to talk about it. It's great that you're acknowledging it, and I hope you're as proud of it as we are, because certainly what you do on Bedford Common to educate the community is really big. So maybe I'll have to put that in the application next year.
We would be happy to help. We would be happy to help. Thank you both for being with us.
Yep.
Thank you
for having us.
Oh, thank you for coming, and stay with us. We're going to lose Sue, but we'll be right back with the chief in just a minute. Don't go away.
Hey, Bedford, how you doing?
Hi, Bedford. I love Bedford Day.
Bedford, Alex.
Hello, Bedford. Shalom uvracha.
We're back. We have lost Ms. Baldauf, but we've kept the police chief because we want to talk about your first year here. We had you on a year ago talking about what you wanted to do with the town, and I have an extensive set of notes here.
See if we met expectations.
Exactly. But no, I think the question is, have you met your expectations, and has the job met your expectations?
Well, we coming in, I set lofty goals, and hopefully we met them. We'll let the community decide, but I think it would behoove me to thank the men and women of the Bedford Police Department, because everything that we've accomplished this year, I think we've accomplished because of their dedication and commitment to the community. So I'm very proud of that. And I think that was probably the number one priority coming in. And I can say with confidence that we met that goal. So again, the men and women of this department have really carried our initiatives, moved them forward, and made us a better police department and a community, I think.
Well, very good. So, what you looking for the, no.
It'll be a short interview.
There you go. No, one of the things that you had talked about last year was community policing.
Correct.
And becoming a part of the community. A couple of things that I noticed just in the last couple of days, the police department now has a very well-populated Facebook page and
Correct.
A newsletter.
Well, thank you for that. And that opened up the next segue. We're really trying to use 21st century technology to connect with our people, with our residents. As you mentioned, we have a new enhanced website, and that was new this year. We have an internal crime bulletin that we're doing for the police officers. And one of the things that you mentioned is we'll be developing a community newsletter, which we'll be distributing at least quarterly to the residents, and that's available, as well as using Twitter and Facebook and other social media networks. So we're really trying to connect with the community, use the technology we have today, and get some feedback and good communication.
So we want to go to if we're on Facebook, we want to go and we want to like the police department. And that way, you can get all the news when it comes out, when
Correct.
It gets posted.
Correct.
How do we like the police department?
Very well, thank you.
No, that really was a bad choice.
I couldn't. You left it open,
let's
though.
Let's try this again. How does one find you on Facebook?
Well, that's good. We have some links through our website. So if you come onto our website, you can do it that way. And again, one of our goals, I think, was using 21st century technology. Two people that really should be acknowledged is Officer Mark Saucier and Stephen Waite, who are really taking that technology and expanded it. If my technology capabilities are very limited, so it's nice to have officers that have the technology and the knowledge to do that.
Well, and they write darn good press releases, too.
I agree with that as well.
Darn good press releases.
The other thing is, you mentioned community policing. I think one of the things that we did is we initiated a community services unit, which encompasses and umbrellas all of our community policing programs. So it entails all the programs that we offer the community, RAD, Safe Routes to School, our police open houses. It incorporates our public relations and some of our traffic initiatives. So that was one of our accomplishments in 2012, was forming this unit, I think, again, with the goal of community policing and developing partnerships with the community.
Well, and a couple of days ago you had, and we're doing this in early November, so this was something that happened in the middle of October, Operation Bright Yellow, what was it called?
Yes, Operation Yellow Blitz.
Yellow Blitz,
so
there you go.
So what that incorporated was we dedicated officers from our traffic unit to follow school buses. And it was a state initiative that Bedford picked up. And again, it's one of those things that, you know, makes the community feel safe. It's a reassuring component to the parents, knowing that if their children are on the bus, that the police are there enforcing any violations. So we did that. We did it on the 24th of October. And I'm happy to report we only had one violation. So that's something, that's good. So I think people are adhering to the traffic laws.
At least when there are police cars. Bite your tongue.
Listen, believe me, this is something I've complained about for years. Anything that will slow down the school buses in this town is a good idea.
So you've talked about school buses, but then you also help with safe routes to school.
Correct. The police department is strategically involved with that. So we participate in the International School and Bike Walk to School Day. That's one of the initiatives, and we participate in those monthly meetings with the goal of making the commute safe for our students.
Well, and safe for all of us, because if anything happens, we're all kind of tied in that knot. Right. And then you mentioned RAD. I'm not sure what that is.
It's a rape aggression defense system. So what it is empowers women to defend themselves. It's a 4-week course that really empowers women to defend themselves if they're placed in a risky situation. We really have made that a dedicated program. Even though with our limited resources, we've made that a dedicated program in the police department to provide the women of Bedford. And I encourage all women to partake in that program. The feedback we get after the women accomplishment is amazing, and it's really gratifying to hear some of the great comments.
Well, yes, because while Bedford, knock on wood, doesn't have an aggression problem that needs to be addressed, people get out into the community, they get into other environments where that could be very... How does one sign up? How do you know when it's happening?
If you connect to our website, we're currently ready to run another class, so they can reach out to Officer Deneen, who coordinates that program.
And who is a woman.
Yes, Officer Kristen Deneen. And she spearheads the program, as well as Officer Richie Vitale. So again, they can go onto our website and send an email and register for the class, and we hope we'll have one early fall.
Sounds like a good deal. And then the other two things that I happened to notice were the evening program you did this summer.
National Night Out?
National Night Out, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So National Night Out, again, is one of those community partnership programs. It's done at the national level where we invite the community to meet our police and firefighters. Again, it was a fun event. We had music, we had food, and the community got to meet the officers and the firefighters in a different capacity, in a professional capacity, but a one-on-one capacity. And again, the National Night Out, this is the second year we've done it, and it was very successful. And we look forward to doing that for the years to come.
And then, there were all those kids that came from all over in the sheriff's camp program.
Again,
I came to the mm-hmm. library one day, and the whole parking lot was blocked off, and there were emergency vehicles, and there were people, and it was amazing. I was like, something has happened. And indeed, something had happened, but it wasn't a disaster.
Right, it was a demonstration, I believe, that you're probably referring to.
Yes.
The fire department did to show how to utilize the jaws of life and safely remove an occupant from a crash. And it's always one of the most popular events of the week when the campers get to see that. But again, that's one of the great partnerships that the police and the fire department with the Middlesex County Sheriff Office partner for, something that we offer the community.
We're
Peter
delighted.
Katusian's a good partner to have.
He certainly is. Just recently, he spoke at the Council on Aging just within the last several weeks.
Yeah.
So that's an ongoing series that we have with the Council on Aging where the police department are doing a monthly series. So the first month was an introduction to the police and what services we provide. The second month was we invited Sheriff Katusian in to talk about the partnerships with the local police and how we can support the Middlesex community police chiefs in the area.
Who's coming up next?
Well, next month we're actually having a SWAT demonstration. So Sergeant Toll, who is a SWAT commander in our NEMLAC unit, will be presenting and showing all of the gear and the equipment that they use on a SWAT call.
Bedford has a SWAT team?
We have a regionalized SWAT team in which we partner.
Well, I hope we don't ever have to use it, but tell me more about it.
Sure, it's fascinating, and many people don't realize that, but Bedford, back in the 1960s, joins a consortium called the Northeast Massachusetts Law Enforcement Council, NEMLAC for short. And it was actually cutting edge at the time, and what it visioned was sharing police resources and that's what we do. And the SWAT team is one of many units within the NEMLAC organization. There's a school response team, there's a rapid response team, there's a cyber crime unit. And again, Bedford, we're very proud to be a part of that because it's services that we wouldn't be able to offer the community if we weren't part of this consortium.
Well, that's great.
It certainly is.
So we'll have you back in another year, and well,
thank you.
Well, or before, if you have something you want to share
absolutely.
With the community.
Oh, absolutely, anytime.
Thank you for having me. It's
We're
a pleasure.
Delighted.
Thank
you for We're coming. Delighted to have you in Bedford and with us as our guest.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chief. So stay with us. We will be right back. We're going from police chief to a minister. You work it out. Stay with us.
Maybe not such a bad thing.
I love Bedford.
Hi, it's Amy from Recreation. Thank you for coming to Bedford Day.
Hi, fantastic day at Bedford, lovely weather. We've had fun in the parade, haven't we, Scarlett?
Yeah.
It's been really good. Thank you.
Bedford!
Hi, Bedford.
COA!
Yeah, I'm Vicki Humanator. I work every Saturday from 12 to 4 at the COA. Come join us. Thank you.
We're back, and our guest in this segment is Reverend Christopher Wendell, who is the rector at St. Paul's Church, Episcopal Church, on Pine Hill Road. And Reverend Wendell is here with us today to talk about several interfaith activities that are going to take place in Bedford this November and early December.
That's right.
What's the first one, Chris?
Well, the first one coming up is on November 8th. It's a service of remembrance for Kristallnacht, which celebrates, remembers, the Night of Broken Glass in Germany and Austria, which took place in 1938 during the Holocaust. And we gather on the town common for about 20 minutes at 7 o'clock. And our remembrance includes prayers, a reflection about the significance of the evening. We toll the bell of First Parish, which is right behind the common, and then we light candles as well in remembrance. So everyone in town is invited to come to that, and we hope you will.
And it's quite powerful standing outside.
It is quite powerful. I've been to several of them, probably all of them, and it is quite moving.
It takes different, our celebration here in Bedford takes different forms in different years, but this year will be a fairly simple format, and we hope the weather will be nice enough for us to be outside.
We do too, because I really like that. So after Kristallnacht gets remembered, what happens next?
Well, then I'm very excited because we're hosting, this will be the first time St. Paul's Episcopal Church has hosted an interfaith event since I've been in town. So that's very exciting. And this is on November 18th, which is a Sunday at 2 o'clock. We'll be having our interfaith Thanksgiving service here in town, which this year we're calling a celebration of gratitude.
Wonderful.
Yeah, yeah. So the plan is we actually got, as of this point, seven communities of faith are sending a musical ensemble or choir, and all of the selections will have something to do with gratitude and thankfulness. And interspersed between the musical offerings will be short prayers or reflections or readings by members of clergy in town.
Again, something that used to be extraordinarily well attended and then it kind of fell off. We'll have to see what we can do to make sure everybody knows it's going to take place and that they
right.
need to be there.
Well, we've got seven
we
houses
should
of
put
worship.
It on Bedford Common.
What a good idea! Bedford Common. Have you ever thought about
it? What a good idea.
What a good idea.
Yes, well, we have seven houses of worship participating, so it's not everyone, but it's close.
Mm-hmm.
And we're really, really grateful for all the people who are going to be participating.
And tell me one more time when it's going to take place?
It's Sunday, November 18th at 2 o'clock at St. Paul's, and we'll also be taking a free will offering, totally voluntary, to support the Bedford Food Pantry as well.
A very good,
good
idea.
I'll tell you what I'm thankful for.
What's that?
Here in America, we can do something like this with different religions in the same room without throwing bombs at each other.
You know, I think that gratitude isn't just about our American society, but also about our town of Bedford and our ethos here, because it's not true in every town in America that you can get seven diverse communities of faith coming together to find their areas of common practice. And certainly gratitude for the blessings that we have in our lives is an area of deep sympathy among many of the world's traditions.
Amen to that.
Amen. And what a nice way to spend the Sunday afternoon before Thanksgiving.
Exactly.
And when that's done.
Well, I'll say one more word about an interfaith event that's coming up in December, which is a new thing for Bedford. We haven't done this before, but some of my colleagues from other congregations and I are planning something called the Longest Night Service.
For midwinter.
Yeah, so this is a celebration that will be held right around the time of the winter solstice. We actually are not doing it on the winter solstice because there's apparently a great concert happening in Concord that night.
Uh-oh. Well, now we'll know about that, too.
But we're going to do it the Wednesday, December 19th at 7:30, and this will be at the First Church of Christ, the Congregational Church here in town. And the Longest Night is a time especially intended for people for whom the holidays aren't so easy. Mm-hmm. When you are in December, people are generally cheerful and joyful, but not everybody always feels that way, especially if you've lost a loved one and it's the first Christmas or even the 10th or 11th Christmas without them, or if the schedules of December and the consumerism of the holiday drives you nuts. You can feel a little bit less exuberant in your joy. So this is a time for people who, for whom the holidays aren't so easy all the time, to get together and acknowledge that and be at peace with that and try to find some solidarity and support amongst each other.
Amen and blessed be.
Yeah.
Amen
yeah.
and blessed be. But for people for whom the holidays are not so troublesome, you have a little something coming up
right.
at St. Paul's.
So those three are interfaith events, but I would be remiss not to, and also I'd be in big trouble with my congregation, if I didn't also tell you a little bit about St. Paul's Advent Fair.
Which a long-standing Bedford tradition.
A huge long-standing Bedford tradition. In fact, I brought a gift basket. With
oh, you
me.
Shouldn't have. For me?
I don't think he did. I think this is just
this
a sample.
This could be yours if you come on Saturday, December 1st, the first Saturday of the month, as it always is. First Saturday of December is our annual Advent Fair, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. Over at St. Paul's, which is at 100 Pine Hill Road. And we have lots of gifts, that have been put together. We have over 100 gift baskets kind of like this, except each one is a different theme. We've got ones for dog lovers. We've got ones for bridge players. We've got ones for people who like to make muffins. I mean, you pick, if you have an interest, we got a gift basket.
So far, you've mentioned three things I like very much.
Then I'll see you there, because I got some of the best Christmas decorations last year.
Thank you. Well, we also have wonderful handmade jewelry and vintage jewelry as well. And items from our country kitchen and various things.
And baked beans.
And baked beans, yes. And the woman who makes our baked beans is passing on that torch this year because she's going to be unable to make them.
That's
for the
right.
first
that was
time.
Jan Blake.
Jan Blake, yeah.
Yes.
But we're hopeful that Jan will make it to the fair.
It would be wonderful. I'll come get her if you'd like me to and do the
driving.
That
would be wonderful. I think we'll find a way to get her there. It's such a community event, and she's been part of it for a long time, as have so many people in Bedford. So we really hope that everyone will turn out on Saturday, December 1st, from 9 to 2 at St. Paul's.
Well, that's great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming here and sharing this, all of these great events going on with us.
Thank you for having me back.
It's the holidays. I'm singing
is.
Again.
Oh, God.
I know.
It's hard to imagine. We're almost there.
It is hard to imagine, but we are.
Well, this is the November show, and in fact, that was the November show, because we're done. But two more events to remind you of again. If you're watching this early in the month, Tuesday, November 6th, is the election day, big election day.
Federal election, federal, state, everybody.
Everybody, and I will say what I always say, if you don't vote, don't complain to me.
And then
the next Tuesday, November 13th, is town meeting. Tuesday, not Monday, Tuesday, November 13th, at 7:30, usual time, usual channel, but Tuesday, not Monday.
And that is because Veterans Day, while Bedford, the Patriotic Ceremonies Committee, will be celebrating on Sunday, November 11th, Monday is the holiday, and so town meeting is going to be on Tuesday.
So there.
We will see you after Veterans Day at town meeting.
And we will see you in December.
Happy holiday.
No, wrong. Please don't stop.
I torture him, don't I?
You do.
Thank you, Bedford.
Good night, Bedford.